Bowman is Sujata Noronha, Bowman is Geetanjali Kulkarni, and Bowman is Geeta Ramanujam. Magta, Kukuni Bal Sahityika, Bowman is Usha Kamat Hanjilagi, Manista Manar Machir Ganyoje. Bowman is Sujata Noronha, Bowman is Geeta Ramanujam, Bowman is Geetanjali Kulkarni. Dev Bargaru Shatai. Sujata Noronha is an educator with an MPhil in education from the Tata Institute of Social Sciences. She is presently the director of Bookworm Trust, a library-based organization in Goa dedicated to the act of reading. Through Bookworm Trust, Sujata and her team of library educators innovate and implement a diverse variety of programs that nurture relationships with books and the act of reading. Next we have Geeta Ramanujam. She is the founder and executive director of the Kadalaya Trust. She has traveled to the nook and cranny of India, Japan, Brazil, Eastern Europe, the UK, the US, and the Latin America, telling and hearing, sharing and collecting stories. She is an Ashoka Fellow and the Indian Coordinator for the International Storytelling Network, RIC, and the Coordinator for the Indian Storytelling Network. The last we have Geetanjali Kulkarni. She has worked as an actor in professional as well as experimental plays in Marathi and Hindi. She is associated with Quality Education Support Trust, an NGO, working in the field of education in rural and tribal areas of Maharashtra for the last 10 years. She heads the project Goshtarang Fellowship Program, in which children's literature is performed in schools of rural and tribal areas as a part of Reading Writing Enhancement Program. Sagayam Pratigna Yukar and Satraka Meta Surbat Kurtar, Maktam Bomani Sujata Noronha Anchilangi, Tanya Plevichar Pargatauje.
A good day and wonderful for me to see what I hear is over 700 teachers in this one room. So teachers, thank you, because I never thought I'd be in Goa and be in a room with 700 teachers. So I'm incredibly excited. Thank you for coming. Truly, I think one of the hardest challenges in all our work is getting the support of teachers in becoming part of what I hope is a movement to awaken to what are the possibilities of things we can do with story and books. And I really want to congratulate the Konkani Bhasha Mandal for making this possible, for having something like this Bal Sahitya Parishad for the second time, for bringing us together to talk about books and what we are now saying is children's literature. I want to thank Chetan very specially, and I'm doing this right at the beginning, because Mr. Chetan Acharya called me 2.5 months back and said, block these dates. And if he hadn't done it, I would have found today really hard, because for the last 2 days, we are trying to shift a library and an office from Taligaon to Malla in Panjim. And shifting a library is like shifting a whole apartment building of about 20 houses in like 24 hours with 8 strong women. Very, very hard task. So today I dragged myself out specifically because there were so many teachers in the room and I knew I'd meet other distinguished colleagues and I felt I had to be here this morning. So thank you to Chetan and to Prashant and the whole team who have put this together. They've been very kind, answering questions I was sending by email and helping me form some thinking about how can I address you in terms of opening this idea of means and medium of taking children's literature or opening children's literature. I have to confess, a very big confusion with this topic. And I wrote to Prashant, whom I now understand has a very efficient secretary in Anvesha, saying, what does this mean? What do you want me to talk about? And they said, and I gave them some examples, do you want me to do this, 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 this? And the response was all of the above. And the time I have to execute this is still 20 minutes, of which I've finished 2.5 minutes. So I'm going to try and walk you through what was happening in my mind as I prepared for this 20 minutes. I felt it's very important to first share with you how I think about this whole domain called children's literature, and then very quickly to show you the means and the mediums through which, for the last 14 years through Bookworm Trust, I have been trying to open this idea of relationship with books for children, teachers, and other interested people in Goa. So I want to start with why stories. Our program delighted me by calling me a renowned storyteller. The person who would agree with this is my mother. She remembers me telling stories from the youngest of ages, and these weren't great stories. These were stories of why I didn't do what I had to do, why my brothers couldn't find something because I had done something with it, why I spoke to someone I shouldn't have spoken to, and why I told an aunt about a party we went to which I should not have told her. So I have a long relationship of storytelling, and I think perhaps that's why, as I've grown up and growing older, I'm more and more interested in the act of storytelling. Why stories? Why, even in this 21st century digital age, we are still so interested in stories? And some of my reading makes me think that we are interested in stories because actually stories are really the way in which we think. Stories and thinking are very, very closely enmeshed. And if you think about it, your mind is all the time recording information, events, solutions, more ideas, in ways that psychologists have defined as called it the storying mind, the way in which we keep scripts, we record events and narratives. We're doing it all the time, quite automatically. And then when we read and when we expose ourselves to thousands of different ideas and ways in which those ideas are told, we grow our storing mind. And when we grow our storing mind, we become stronger thinkers. And when we become stronger thinkers, the whole hope is that we become stronger actors. We'll start making choices and decisions that are coming from our minds rather than coming from what a large group of people are telling us we have to do. And my whole investment of why I think reading is important resides here. I think we need to become stronger, independent thinkers. And funnily and happily, that can happen through the act of stories. So I continue to be deeply disappointed when I hear teachers say, we can have stories, moral stories, dakte stories. And the whole imagination is that stories are something that happen after all the real work is done, something that happens after all the big ideas are thought. But stories are actually the big ideas. Every big idea is actually a story. So, thank you, Chiri. So really, I want to place for teachers this opening. If you can rethink, what do you think stories are about? You might begin to imagine your teaching differently, and you might be more open to the idea that libraries and storybooks and stories have legitimate places in our classrooms. So if we agree, and I'm assuming all of you are agreeing with me now, that stories are important, stories are the way in which we come to know about ourselves and the world, we must remember there's not one type of story. And this is the new danger in this new age of mass publication. Quickly books come out, quickly. I can be an author tonight if I rush home, write a story, print it on my machine, run to a shop, get 1,000 copies, and have a network to go and put it into schools. Tomorrow there can be a press note calling me a published author. Much is changing in this world, and much is changing in our children's lives, and classrooms are suddenly getting books given by someone, donated by someone, sponsored by someone. And I have a big question. Should all these books be in our classrooms and in our children's lives? Is every book that is printed a good book? Is every book, anything that is available right now, comes under this domain that we are calling children's literature. I feel these are very important questions, and I feel this is where the gaze of the teacher, the mind of the teacher, must start opening up. What makes something a piece of literature? What makes a story a good story that I feel, yes, I must have this book in my class. I must read it to my children. I must read it for myself. These are just not high-level questions. They are everyday questions. But if you keep asking them of yourself, I think you'll change the way you also look at storybooks and open your classroom to stories. So I was again slightly sad this morning, standing in line, waiting for my entry into the table to look for books for our own library. And I could hear teachers asking for books on tables, copywriting, opposites. Somebody wanted a book on essays. And it's 2018. These were the questions my teachers in 1980 were perhaps asking, because nobody had opened up this world that books are of different kinds, that there's a world in storybooks that every child deserves to hear. And again, we can hold our teacher training institutions at question, we can hold, you know, our own school managements in question, but we also have to take responsibility. If you chose to be a teacher, you have a responsibility to be updated about what is happening. And the world of children's books, particularly in India at this time, is perhaps at its biggest burst. And if you don't know that, then that's a bit sad. And then your children will only get the times table book, the copywriting book, the book about some essay they can learn and repeat. And they are being denied this world of stories. And I hope it is initiatives like this that begin to open teachers' minds on what is the possibility, what is happening in the world of children's publishing. Pluto is an extremely fine example of perhaps right now one of the finest little magazines I've seen for young children. But it wouldn't have reached our schools yet, and many of us would not be aware of a magazine like Pluto. And that's just one example, because Taposhi was here and I wanted to bring that in. So I really want teachers to know that stories are of various types, that our children and our classrooms and our schools deserve all these types of stories. And how do these stories come in? It's not just books. It is definitely this idea that literature is no longer imagined as just something that is written, even though the word came from that trajectory. We're looking at anything, actually. Art, poetry, sayings, stories, even a good, well-written speech can be considered a part of this umbrella of literature. But there are certain inherent qualities in it that make it literature, and something might make it not literature. And these are also problematic areas. People in power decide what goes into the textbook because it's a piece of literature, and what stays out of a textbook. Again, many of us will make decisions what books to keep in the collection. If it's not in Konkani, then we are not keeping these books, because right now we are all wanting to promote Konkani. We need to think about these things. You know, is this the best way in which we can bring ideas to our children? Is this the only way in which we can bring ideas to our children? I want to urge each of you to actually start thinking. And so part of my whole focus for the next few minutes is going to be to incite you. And I hope some of you are getting irritated and not happy with what I'm saying, because that's when thinking opens up. It would be really simple for me to say everything that you want to hear, and then you'll clap for me and we'll go home happy. But I wanted to make my 20 minutes meaningful. For me, it's important that you all, as teachers in schools working with hundreds of children every year, you start thinking. And one way to start thinking is to start asking questions. And in Goa, I feel we do not ask enough of questions of the right people. And we must. If we want a future for our children in this region and for children all over this country, I think as responsible adults, we have to start asking questions. And the best way to ask questions is to read stories, because stories provoke questioning. And in a democratic open classroom, children will be encouraged and be delighted to ask questions. And in some ways, that's one of the means or the mediums in which we actually take stories to children in Goa, where we read them and we demand over time that children start raising questions about those stories. And there is no such thing as the right answer. But in the act of questioning and thinking and talking, we're opening up our way of thinking and forming newer ideas that we know are coming from the fact that we are being introduced to stories in the first place. So another interesting aspect for me that emerged when I was thinking about coming here and talking to you is, what is children's literature and how is that different from literature for adults? And it's interesting because Bookworm started as a children's library 13 years ago, and it's grown into a little larger organization that's doing a number of things. But many, many people still think that we are a children's library, which is a very important thing. But when they think that, they're also thinking, they work with children. And it's a children's library. Almost like there's a paucity of ideas there. There cannot be much there because it is children and it's a library. But the joy for me over the last few years has been curating a collection of books at Bookworm, buying very carefully selected books that right now gives us perhaps one of the finest children's book collections in the country. And I'm extremely proud, on one hand, that there are people, research scholars, people working in NGOs all over who will come to spend 3 or 4 days in Bookworm to read our books. The sadness is, very, very rarely anyone from Goa comes to Bookworm to read our books. And we sit there, open, welcoming, requesting you to come. And you don't, as a community. And we take responsibility. Perhaps you don't know we exist, and that's one part of the problem. But the other is, if you are not interested in children and books, then you're unlikely to take the time to come. But I can see today that you are interested, otherwise you wouldn't be here in such large numbers, and that's so, so good. So I'm going to find out from the Konkani Bhasha Mandal how I get those registration form details, and I'm going to send an invitation to each and every one of you so that you can all come to the library at whatever time you want in the course of this year, and we can introduce our collection to you. Because when you know what is there in children's books, the means and the mediums and the ways to take those books to children will start opening by themselves. But first you have to be open. And I think everything starts with us, with each of us as teachers and adults. And the last kind of thought I wanted to leave you before I share with you this means and mediums or the ways in which we take books is, if you actually understand why anyone is doing what they want to do, the how becomes very simple. And so because there was a vision in my mind many years back to work with children and to work with the act of reading, it became simple that I had to take books and take the collections and the stories that I love to places where children are, because it's, even though Goa is small, our mobility is always restricted because of a extremely poor public transport system, because of rivers we have to cross that become somehow mental barriers, that we don't really cross across the state as much as people perhaps do in larger places. So the idea was then, how can we take books where children are, because those children are not coming to us. And in time I realized it's not just the books, I had to work with the adults who are also with children. And in that way our work has grown and strengthened. And what I will do now is very briefly, Sneha, yes, will help me. I have a slideshow of sorts of the kind of ways in which we've taken books and the act of reading to communities and the services we offer. Not at all. And I hope in some ways these become very small catalysts for you to start thinking of ways in which you yourself can begin to open up this absolutely wonderful area of collections and reading for children in our state. So I'm sharing this like a journey, and it has years, so it just tells you, you know, at different points in our lives what we did. So this was our library in Taligaon till 2 days back, and it's now doesn't look like this. We have a new library, but we set up in 2005. On the 10th of September is our birthday. And we work with all ages, reading to them and with them, inviting various groups of children to the library. We started a magazine way before anyone was ready for a children's magazine here. And this is one of the projects that did not last. But children who subscribe to our magazine, many of them are now adults or graduate students, and it's so wonderful to hear them ask me how the magazine is doing. They remember issues of the magazine. In 2007, I began what I thought would be the simplest thing to do, put books in boxes and drop them off at schools. And so I'd send books like this in plastic crates to different schools who seemed interested. And then I realized 2 years later that many of the books were still sitting in the crates in those schools and nothing was happening with them. And so eventually I did something with that. But right now I need unleash, no snake. Sorry. I don't know. Thank you. I do this. It's okay. And in 2009, we began a formal outreach program of taking books in a small red van to children and communities. This is perhaps the reason I get up every morning. I love going and reading stories to children. And I do a lot of this. And I have learned incredible amounts from doing this kind of work. I'm delighted that a number of young people continue to volunteer at Bookworm, to do internships at Bookworm. The irony again is that these are more people from out of Goa who apply to work at Bookworm than people from within Goa. In 2010, we had this wish that many books in our collection reflected other worlds and didn't reflect worlds that some of us had had in Goa and did not find in books. So we decided to publish a few books. Again, I'm no business person. I have absolutely no head for numbers and money. And so this didn't do very well, but I enjoyed putting out 7 books and have now decided we won't do any more. This is a book on language and literacy, and Maxine has been my teacher for many years, and so I did a book dedicated to her. In 2011, we started a libraries in school program. There are some of our schools we work with, some of the teachers here, and I'm so delighted that they are with us today. This school program we run ourselves. We take boxes of books and loads of library educators. We go into schools and we read to children, give out books, talk, think, and construct ideas with groups of children in classrooms across the state. This year we are working in 17 schools. And it's been a very slow journey, but I'm deeply grateful to every school that partners with us. In 2012, I made a commitment to the Goa Arts and Literature Festival that I would try and organize a small festival on the sidelines. You can see how Jerry looked in 2012. He was my opening speaker from then until last year. Every year, Jerry opens our small gathering for, again, school children and children in the community. And we now have it where the festival happens. That's at the International Center in Dona Paula. We began another large community program, and I'd be delighted if any of you are interested. It's an open reading program in the park. We go with boxes of books, volunteers, and we just sit and read to children. We welcomed older readers into the library in 2014. Before that, it was a children's library only. And then I realized that adults were not coming in, and children are always at the mercy of adults. So without the adult, the children won't come. We do a lot of small research studies, but the big one I wanted to share with you was a child literacy in Goa study, which looked at how our children are reading in standard 5. The study was to look at how they are reading in English, because most of our schools, or nearly all our schools, shift to English from 5th. And the study gave us very, very hard results, which sadly didn't percolate into the system. But less than 8% of the children in standard 5 were reading at standard 3 level. and that is a problem. And when we read news reports that people are failing eligibility tests, actually the whole point is if you are not able to read, you're not able to learn. And so if we don't recognize this as a community of educators, we're really in a big problem. And there's warning from the wings, so I'm going to quickly tell you about Bookstops, which is an open free library program, about Torchlight, which is our online journal, where we try to bring together ideas around library and reading all over from all over India. And we do events, these are in Bangalore, where we get invited to do things. We've set up a number of libraries for the Tibetan community in Dharamshala and Mungod, and also in Sagar and Shimoga. And we invite other organizations, teaching groups to Bookworm for what we call exposure visits, to come and learn about how we run a library so that you can take those ideas and go back to where you are from. And last year we began a professional development course where we're teaching adults what we've learned in the last 10 years and more on how you run a library for children, either in schools or in communities. And again, this year I'm saddened to tell you that we have participants even from Afghanistan who have enrolled for our course, but we have nobody from Goa. And on that really happy note, knowing that from today onwards perhaps we'll affirm to do things differently, I thank you for listening. And I hope we see a change in children and reading in this state. Thank you.
Namaste. Namaste.
Namaste.
Very good, you're all alive. Wonderful. We're going to do something. When I say yes, you will say no. That's what children do, right? So when I say yes, you'll say
no.
Fantastic. Okay, yes,
no,
yes,
no.
Yes,
no.
Yes, no,
yes,
super, great, wonderful. The most important thing for transaction, thank you very much. Anything to come alive, we need two people. One, the teller, and one, the
listener.
Fantastic. But I'm also a listener, because if you listen, then my tone will go, isn't it?
Yes.
So the energy comes from the
listener.
Very good. So the most important thing, in order to transact anything, to communicate, to connect with our souls, with our hearts, with a lot of love, whether it's teachers, parents, anyone, is to be able to listen. We do listen to machines, I know. We do listen to our... It's passive listening. It's not active listening. I have taught a lot, right up to 10th grade, history, social science. I've been in this field now, I've been working non-stop for 38 years. So I was a teacher, librarian, a lot of things have gone round the world. And yet, if it is only 20 minutes, what do I transact is very important. So as I said, childhood plays a great part in our upbringing. I'm thankful to everyone who's invited me today to speak here. I'll take a few cues from what was said in the morning. One was, what hit me is oral literature, which also boils down to something called storytelling. In its purest form, telling a story means telling a story. Isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. So my mother, when I was young, Bhasha plays a very important part. How do you learn a language? The best way to learn a language is when you listen. I'm glad we have an active audience. So, listening, right? So my mother, when I was very young, I actually grew up in Bombay for a little while, of course. And my mother, I speak Tamil. So it's not Tamil, it's not Tamiz, it is Tamil. Okay, so R is a very important part in Tamil. Okay? Yes. So, Yerepayan Vyarakkaramei Vaarapparathil Vadikki Vidinda. Okay. Betty bought a bottle bit of butter, make the bitter butter better. Betty bought a bottle bit of butter to make the bitter butter better. Isn't it? If you know your regional tongue well, if you can speak in your language with pride, you can pick up any language. Don't you agree?
Yes.
Fantastic. We cannot import things all the time. We need to also localize first, and then we can export ourselves, which is what I've been doing now, right? Okay, so my mother, when I was very young, we didn't have machines, thank God. We didn't have a television. The first big tape recorder in my house was when I was in the 10th standard. But then my mother, my language was English, first language, second language, Hindi, third language, Marathi. There was no fourth language. And my mother had to teach me Tamil because she came from Tanjavur, a very culturally rich place. My father, though he was a gold medalist in English, he chose to do chemistry. He wanted to be different. So, I'm going to set that apart. So, in my house, I had two tasks to do. One was that I had to grind chutney every day. Because there was a big, large family at home. And we were about 12 children. Cousins, children, everything. I was the oldest. In those days, there was no child rights, human rights. Only one answer. If you ask my mother what, she'll give one pat. Okay? So, my mother in the morning was very busy. She had to pack a lot of dabbas. So there she gave me that, you know, in those days chutney was ground in that stone. We called it in Tamil, we call it ammi. Okay, so she would put something in that ammi and then she will say, listen. When she said listen, it meant you can't take her for granted. So I'll wait when she's going to open her mouth and then she'll say, don't grind like this. When you come to the center, go slow. Second instruction. When it is this consistency, take it out. Third, wash, dry the whole thing towards the sink before you leave. This was the most interesting part. Don't be like that E that forgot its name. E in Tamil means makki or housefly. So she'll add that. Don't be like that housefly that forgot its name. At that time, I can't ask my mother, Ma, tell me, you know, what is how. Because you know what my mother will give. So I would go to school thinking, why the housefly forgot its name. When I come back in the evening, my mother will be very relaxed. That time I'll ask her, Amma, tell me why that housefly forgot its name. And this is the story she would tell. Korokora kandre, kandrin taye, taayin vodaya, odayin kayil kole, kole chuttum kodiye, kodi vadarum kulame, kulatil nirkum kokke, kokku pidikkum meene, meen pidikkum valaya, valayin kayil chatti, chatti pidikkum koyavan, koyavan tarum manne, manmel vadarum pulle, pulle thinkum kudaraye, en per enna. This is a story. Now I will translate it because I'm sure you didn't understand a syllable.
But we love the sound.
Fantastic. Why aren't you all clapping?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I also need motivation, right? So now I'll translate it for you. So the housefly forgets its name. So it goes to the calf. You know the calf, bachda. And says, tell me what's my name. The calf says, ask my mother from whom I drink milk. The mother is who?
Cow.
Cow. So the cow says, "Bah, how do I remember your name?" And then says, "Ask the stick that drives me." The stick says, "Dr, dr." Ask the creeper that grows over me. The creeper says, "Ask the pond in which I grow." The pond says, "Ask the crane who stands whole day on one leg." The crane says, "Ask the fish that I catch." The fish says, "Ask the net that falls over me." The net says, "Ask the fisherman who throws the net." Yeah. The fisherman says, "Ask the pot in which I collect the fish." The pot says, "Ask the potter who makes me into a pot." The potter says, "Ask the mud which I mix with the clay." The mud says, "Ask the grass that grows over me." By this time, our friend the housefly is fed up. Because he's going and asking, "What is my name? What is my name?" Nobody knows the name. Just as he gives up, there is a horse. And the horse comes there and says, "Yee! I remember my name." And it flies back. Yes? My mother wouldn't stop there. Next step, step number two. Tell me how many characters I was very bad at math. So I would stare at her. But she didn't want to make me feel awkward. Okay, don't worry, she said. First, tell me, the housefly went to whom first?
Calf.
From the calf to
cow.
The
cow.
Cow to
stick.
Stick to
creeper
to
pond
to
crane
to
fish
to
net
to net to
fisherman
to
pot
to potter to mud. Okay. Mud to? Grass to the?
Horse.
You are excellent. Give yourselves a big hand. How did you remember?
Connection.
Interesting story.
Connection.
I can hear only a...
Story!
No, but everyone's been telling stories from morning.
Connected.
Sorry.
Connection.
How did you recall?
Connection.
Linking what?
Connection.
What is that connection?
Audio.
Huh? Audio?
No, logic.
But tell me exactly what happened in your brains.
Logic.
Picture. Visualization. Fantastic. See, even today in all this technological era, when someone speaks something and when you listen with one important thing, why do we put money in the bank?
Interest.
We get?
Interest.
Interest. So when you listen with?
Interest.
Then you can visualize, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes. We need illustrators, we need books, but I'm telling one step before that. We naturally can visualize, but because today we speak very fast, that there is no room for visualization. Anything else I can do? You, I'm Ayatel, from Ayatel, I'm speaking, I heard you had a finished. Problem not solved still. Is there anything else I can do for you, ma'am? Right? So, we don't have time to see the story. A good communicator, a good transaction of knowledge, teachers especially, need to let the child see the story. Don't you agree?
Yes.
Yes, wonderful. Then you can count characters. Then you can draw. Then you can find out what is that habitat. What do you think was the surrounding, the environment of this place?
Village.
It was a village, isn't it?
Yes.
Then you can say in the village of Tanjavur, this story happened. You can put the location, you can teach them geography, you can teach them math, you can teach them anything. Because now you have listened with
interest.
So when you listen, which is the first step of any learning, especially in oral tradition, when you listen, you retain. This is your memory box. You recall and you retell. That is reinforced through reading and writing. Now you read out a book to your child aloud, the child is going to be interested. Isn't it? Don't you agree?
Yes.
Yes. So we're not doing any part of this at all. So when you tell a story, you can teach a lot of concepts. You can teach sounds. The child listens to your body language. Isn't it? Teachers drag themselves into the class. Good morning. Sit down. Open your books. So no life, isn't it? Dangling. Yeah? Okay, so storytelling plays a very important part in transaction of knowledge. Earlier times in a lot of Gurukula systems, they were known as nyayas of learning. Nyayas of learning, right? So it's a huge ocean. So it's wonderful if we all can muster up to speak clearly, to speak slowly, to speak the right regional tongue, and then see if you can speak any other language too very easily, right? Yes. Agreed?
Agreed.
Yes. The second step I'm coming to is, when you want to read aloud too, you can probably stress on a few points. Have you seen a child telling a story? There are a lot of competitions you have, right? How do child mugs up the story? Because you help them to mug up everything. Once upon a time, there was a crow, a very dirty, and then pushed to us, and flew away happily. Story over. Theatrical. I don't have to say, once upon a time there was a crow. I don't have to do that. It is not theater. It is storytelling. That's it. You don't have to be too dramatic. Yeah? So, ma'am, we can't, ma'am. This is the first thing. We can't. Because we can't do voices like you. No, you don't have to. Tell your story well, that's enough. Use a little sounds if that's your strength. I also train a lot of government school teachers all over Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. So one person, it's only how you take it, right? One person wanted to show off or wanted to tell me how he told that story because I had to evaluate. How long do you think this crow story will take?
2 seconds,
5 seconds, maximum 1 minute, right? Now half an hour class. So he started. Once, there was one, what? Staring at him. Then he was so happy. There was one crow. See, children, there are different types of crows. Some crows are black neck. even our rural school children know how crows look. Now children, you know, being children, anywhere, they started making sound. Then he had one big stick. Listen to story. Today morning, on my kitchen roof, one crow, tappa 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 sound. I didn't know whether it was raining or it was a crow. What nuisance! Children again started talking. Then he went into different types of water filters. Today we are in an age of technology. And he dragged the story for exactly half an hour. As soon as the bell rang, the children all ran away. So how to murder a story can also be done. Yes? So you need to have, it doesn't mean that I know a story, I can tell I'm a storyteller. You need to have a sense of timing. You need to listen to the listeners. You need to listen to the listeners. Right? You need to see what is their interest. It's important, no? Whereas in another school, no classroom at all. You know how government schools are, 1 to 4 multi-grade learning. There was a lady who was telling the story like this. Kage bondu neerike hari hari banditu egiri egiri nintitu bayari nintitu sannadondu hoojili haniya neeru kanditu aase inda noditu neere yettikalilla sanna sanna kallalu tandu tandu tumbalu neeru mele barallu hotte tumba kudiyitu burranta haritu sarranta hoyitu. Do we need any aid for this? Any charts, any books, any illustrations? Under a tree, 200 children sitting there, pin drop silence, because that teacher used her strength. We don't need anything, we need only our hearts. Lot of love in our heart. Because I, as a teacher, as a facilitator, I'm shaping the future thought process of that child who's listening to me. Right? So it's important how. So how you tell a story, you can tell a story anyway. For instance, I'll just show you. There is time, no? 2 minutes. Okay. All right. So can you see this? Can you see? Yeah. So if I have to use a prop, how do I tell? It'll be different, isn't it? Every time I use something, it'll be different. So. Oh, he says nobody's clapping for him. Okay, so once upon a time, Kaka was very thirsty. He rested because he was very thirsty. Then he heard a sound. Found a pot of
water.
Couldn't reach the bottom. What to do? Throw some stones. Water came up.
drank the water. He says he loves you all a lot. Can you tell them how much you love him? I love them. Oh, that much. Say thank you. Bye bye. Okay, thank you so much. I just want to end with one very short story. Once upon a time, there was a cat. And she was a very proud mother cat. Because she had three little kittens. And those three kittens were. Cat was happy when she turned and at the door she saw a dog and his mouth was watering because he saw the three
kittens.
What will the mother do? She turned and she did. Boo! The dog ran away. The three kittens looked up at the mother with curiosity and wonder. This is something we get from childhood. Why? What? How's that noise? Right? So they looked up. And the mother said, "It's always good to know a second language." Everyone who's invited me enough for making me alive here for such a wonderful audience, and I'm 100%, no, 200% sure you're going to carry 0.0001% of what I've been speaking about in your classes, aren't you?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Very good. Thank you very much. Thank you, ma'am.
Today. विचारांची देवाण करण्यासाठी मी आमंत्रित करते गीतांजली कुलकर्णी यांना.
I'm not standing here because I'm very short.
You won't see me. After this wonderful presentation, I don't know what I'm going to speak. I'm an actor, so I can't address such a big audience and put my views because I'm always hiring words from authors. So what I'll do. I'll just tell you one story that why we started Goshtarang. Goshtarang is a project where we take children's literature and perform them in a dramatic form and take it to schools and basically rural and tribal schools where they don't get an opportunity to see performances, they don't read, they don't write, they don't have books, and they come from a very unprivileged background. So our main motto of Quest, where I work with this NGO called Quest, Quality Education Support Trust, our main motto is to give quality education to underprivileged students, underprivileged children who go to schools who are they don't speak the standard language. They have their own language. Their language is very beautiful, but like Geeta ma'am said, they have to. They have to know the other language also, the second language also. So since 10 years I've been working with this NGO. I've been training teachers with my theater craft so that they can use in the classroom. But I always felt that I don't have a proper direction. I'm doing these workshops which are very, which don't have a particular aim or focus. So after a while, 4 years back, we decided, our director Nilesh Nimkar told me that I think you should just concentrate on children's story and we should only perform for children. And then we did a pilot project. We created 7 stories and we took it to 7 villages nearby our center. So in that, we performed one story called Itku Pitku Akashwani Var. It's a Marathi story by Shailaja Raj. It's an old story where Itku Pitku are two mice who go to Akashwani. Akashwani is the radio station. So their journey to Akashwani. So we used props, we used puppets as mice. And there were two actors who were handling those puppets. We were in this village called Sonshiv, and of course we were performing in, you know, open areas, in temples, in schools, wherever we got space. So there was this table and there were these two actors who were handling these puppets, and there was a narrator who was telling the story. So one 8-year-old girl who was an Adivasi girl, I don't know whether she went to the school or not, but when we were performing, she came here and saw the whole 20-minute performance from behind. She was not sitting in the front and seeing the performance, but she came behind and she wanted to see what the puppeteers were doing. That was the curiosity, and that was the point when I decided we have to perform stories to these children, because that's going to make them more curious about how stories are performed, and maybe that will be an instigator, you know, to go to books and read them and find the beauty of the whole world of literature. So I'm just going to show a 3-minute audio visual so that you understand that where we work, in what conditions we work, what we do exactly, what is the focus, and then it will be followed by a performance with my team. I'm so happy that the organizers allowed me to bring my actors here, and they've performed the story in 100 schools, and they've taken it to almost 15,000 students. But before that, a 3-minute audio visual about our organization and about the project which we do. Sneha, could you understand?
आमचं काम सुरू होतं. आम्ही सगळे नाटकाच्या माध्यमातून पुस्तकातली जादुई दुनिया मुलांसमोर उलगडून दाखवतो. या मुलांसारखीच आदिवासी समाजात जन्मलेली मोयना कशी निडरपणे प्रश्न विचारतीये हे पाहताना मुलं गुंग होऊन गेली. प्रत्येक गोष्ट सादर केल्यावर त्या गोष्टीचं पुस्तक मुलांना आवर्जून दाखवलं जात. सादर करण्याच्या गोष्टी मुलांच्या वयोगटाचा विचार करून निवडल्या जातात. 5वी ते 7वीच्या मुलांसाठी कधी कधी कण्णा पडण्यासारखी गंभीर गोष्ट सादर केली जाते. गोष्टीतला कण्णासारखा अंध कथानायक पाहताना मुलं अंतर्मुख होतात. पुस्तकातल्या गोष्टी अशा जिवंत होऊन मुलांसमोर आल्या की मुलं आपोआप पुस्तकांकडे ओढली जातात. पुस्तक पेटीतून बाहेर येऊन मुलांच्या हातात दिसू लागतात. मुलं पुस्तकं वाचू लागतात.
लिखाणामध्ये बरंच त्यांनी बदल केला म्हणजे त्यांची भाषा चांगली झाली, शब्द वाढले.
या सगळ्या प्रक्रियेत फक्त मुलंच शिकतात असं नाही, आम्ही खूप शिकत चाललो.
Then the Goshtaranga team comes and performs, and then again by going back they again have a group and they have this standee. My voice was reachable?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm a theatre actor, I was confident. So now we are going to present the story Kapiline Ghetla Zhoka by Yujja and Tomas Wieslander, and please enjoy the story, and if you have any questions after that we'll listen to it in the interaction session. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
सायकलच्या मागच्या कॅरियरवर तिनं काहीतरी अडकवलं होतं.
मग कपिला काही पावलं मागे गेली
तुला करावं लागेल.
अरे पण कावळ्या, आता झोपळ्यावर बसून मीच तुला कसं ढकलणार नाही का?
हे काय नाही, तू तुझं बघून घे.
मग कपिलनं ना आपली शिंग हलवली, मी झोपळा काही जायचा हल्लाच नाही. मग तिने पुन्हा आपली शिंग हलवली, शेपटी झटकली, आपले पाय वरती घेतले. पण एका वेळी एकच पाय वरती घेतल्यामुळे पुन्हा झोपळा जास्त लागे ढिम्मच राहिला. मग तिने पुन्हा आपली शिंग हलवली, शेपटी झटकली आणि आपले दोन्ही पाय मागे घेऊन ती थोडी मागे रेलली. आणि मग मग बघा कपिलेचा झोका.
मग कपिलेच्या कानात वारा शिरला, वाऱ्यावर तिची केस उडायला लागली, सगळी फुलपाखरं तिच्या पोटाला गुदगुल्या करायला लागली. काय माझी पाळी, ती झोपड्यावर झुलायची. अगं कपिले, कितीतरी चमत्कारी गोष्टी करण्यात गुंतवलंयस तुम्हाला मगापासून, आणि आता झोपड्यावर झुलायची तुम्ही कावळं. मी कपिले कावळं कधी झोपड्यावर झुलत नाहीत. अगं ते या मुलांचं काम आहे
आणि गाईंचं सुद्धा.
एवढ्यात कावळ्याला ट्रॅक्टरची गरज नाही. हे कपिले झोपाळा थांबू आली ना कुठेतरी,
काय
शेतकरी येतो.
कावळ्या तू झोपाळा थांबव. अरे पण कसा थांबवायचा, तू मला मदत करायला हवीस कावळ्या. तू जर आडवा आला असता थांबेल झोका.
काय आडवा येऊ एका गाईचं होत मी काय ते काही नाही. तू तू काय तू ब्रेकला.
अरे या झोपायला कुठे ब्रेक असतो असं मला नाही वाटत कावळ्या.
ट्रॅक्टरचा आवाज जवळ येतो, आणखी जवळ येतो. कपिले झोपायला थांबत नसेल तर तू उडी मार,
उडी मार. मी आधी झाडामागे लपले कावळ्या.
यावेळी या जंगलात हा शेतकरी काय करतोय कोण असतो नाही बुवा. यावेळी तर तो गोठ्यात असायला हवा ना.
तुम्ही ते काय करतोय
मागे शेतकऱ्याला कळेल ना आपली गायक लपली ती शिंग लपव तुझी शेपूट पण लपव.
माझी शेपटी आत ओढून घेण्याचा प्रयत्न करते ना मी कावळ्या.
कपिले तू ना खूप जाडी आहेस.
मी काय इतकं जाड नाही. हा तुझं हे झाडच ना दिसण्याचं बारीकच आहे.
या मागे या इकडे. अरे तो शेतकरी आता ट्रॅक्टर मधून खाली उतरला आहे आणि तो झाडाच्या दिशेने चालला आहे. तू झाडाखाली येऊन थांबलाय आणि मान वर करून तो झाडाकडे बघतोय. आश्चर्य
कसं आलं आश्चर्य. या जंगलात मध्यभागी झोपळा कसा आला ना हे त्याला कळत नाहीये.
कळत नाहीये. अरे बापरे त्याला काहीच कळत नाही. अरे तू तर चक्क झोपळ्यावर बसलाय. काव काय चका बा चका बा काय चका. अरे अरे बाबा झोपड्यावर बसू नकोस. तू तिथून उठ आणि तुझ्या घरी जा. घरी जाऊन गोठ्यात जा आणि गाईंचं दूध काढ. हो नाही नाही आजच्या पुरतं एवढंच आहे आपल्याकडे. हो बरं आहे. कपिले तू निघालाय, तू जिथे आहेस ना तिथेच
थांब.
एका जागेवर थांब, हलू नको. मी त्याच्या मागे मागे जातो
आणि तू एक्झॅक्टली काय करतो ना हे मी बघते.
मग कावळा झाडा झुडपातून दबकत निघाला, दगडा दगडातून दबकत गेला आणि तो एका झाडाच्या फांदी मागे लपला. शेतकऱ्याने आपलं काहीच दिसलं नाही, त्यानं फक्त आपलं डोकं हलवलं. सरतेशेवटी तो शेतकरी आपल्या ट्रॅक्टर मध्ये बसला आणि ट्रॅक्टरची चाक घराच्या दिशेने वळली. असा ट्रॅक्टरचा आवाज जंगलातून नाहीसा झाला. ए कपिले, कपिलाने शेतकरी गेला, आपण जिंकलो. कसली आली गंमत? अगं इथं माझ्या जंगलात जर एखादा अनोळखी माणूस संशयास्पद हालचाली करत असेल तर त्याच्यावर मी नजर नको ठेवायला.
शेतकरी आता गायीचं दूध काढायला गोठ्याकडे गेला असेल, मलाही जायला हवं. बरं
शेतकऱ्याची टोपी
किती छान मी घेतली. मला ना नेहमी असं वाटायचं की शेतकऱ्याची ही टोपी ना आपल्याला मिळाली. आपण झोपायला उतरवायचं का?
कशाला कशाला उतरवायचं? तो राहू दे ना इथं माझ्या जंगलात माझ्या झाडाला. जर कुणाला झोके घेण्याची इच्छा झाली तर बसता येईल ना तुला झोक्यावर.
पण तूच तर म्हणत अस ना की कावळे कधी झोपड्यावर बसत नाही.
हो काय नाही बसत कावळे कधी झोपड्यावर, पण एखादी गाय इथं आली आणि तिला झोक्यावर बसण्याची इच्छा झाली तर पाहिजे तिथं झोपडा. मग कपिलनं निरोप घेतला आणि आपली सायकल घेऊन ती कावळे वनातून निघून गेली. इतर गायी कधीच गोठ्यात आले होते. शेतकऱ्यांना आधीच गायींचं दूध काढायला सुरुवातही केली होती. कपिल मागील दरवाज्यातून हळूच जात आले.
मी गाय आहे म्हणून तर जगात निरर्थकपणे इकडं तिकडं बघत राहावं असं कुठे. कविलेला घेतला जो काय त्याचा लेखक होता युज्जा आणि टॉमस विस्लँडर आणि हे या गोष्टीचं पुस्तक. थँक्यू.
Now I request the chairman of Konkani Bhasha Mandal, Sir Geetanjali, to give away the token of love to Miss Ashwini Pandey and Santosh Gaikwad for presenting such a wonderful play.
Thank you.